Okay, thank you for the introduction. You can hear me, right? Okay. So I'm going to present our ongoing work on testing database management systems, specifically via a technique that we developed that we called pivoted query synthesis, and which allowed us to detect over 100 bugs in widely used database management systems. First, I want to know something from you. So who of you has actually used or heard of these database management systems? Okay, almost everyone, which is expected because database management systems are really an important component in many systems, especially SQLite, MySQL, and Postgres. We even saw it before on Shanlu's slide set. And to further illustrate this point, I want to present you SQLite. So SQLite is the most widely used database engine in the world. Probably every one of you relies on it because it is built into many computers, into many mobile phones, into all major web browsers, and also embedded into many applications. These database management systems, they are all based on the relational data model. And in the relational data model, we have a database schema that describes so-called tables or relations in a database. So here you can see that we have an animal pictures table with three columns, namely animal, description, and picture, and also here a three records, three rows. In order to manipulate and query data in database management systems, they provide a language that is called a structured query language, or SQL. And here is an example of a SQL query, where basically the query specifies that all picture and description values in these columns should be fetched from this animal pictures table, where this specific condition holds. The general structure or architecture of such system look like this. So we have a client application that sends a query to the database management system. And the database management is expected to go through all the relevant records in the database, basically evaluating whether the condition evaluates to true or false. So here we have two rows for which the condition evaluates to true. And the database management system is then expected to fetch these two records where the condition evaluates to true. In our work, we aim to detect logic bugs in database management systems, which are those bugs where the database management system computes an incorrect result set. And as example here, rather than row 1 and row 2 being fetched, example for logic bug would be that row 1 and row 3 are fetched, so row 2 here is omitted, even though the condition evaluates to true, and here the condition evaluates to false, but the row is fetched nevertheless. I want to show you one specific example of a bug that we found in SQLite. A logic bug, you can see here basically that we create a table, we insert data into this table, update some values and so on, so everything is quite standard, and as you, probably all of you would write SQL statements. To shortly mention here, this analyze statement gathers statistics about tables, which then the query planner can use for a more efficient query planning. Now the result set that we would expect from the database management system to be returned is this one, namely here with three rows. But the actual result set that SQLite returned before we reported this bug is that only a single row here was fetched. And here, a bug in an optimization of the query planner, namely the skip scan optimization, caused this bug. This bug was classified as a high severity bug by the developers. It had existed in SQLite for a couple of years before we found and reported it. What are the challenges for testing database management systems? First of all, they are tested really well. And I again want to demonstrate this on SQLite. So SQLite has about 700 times as much test code as source code, which is already a quite impressive number. SQLite's test cases achieve 100% branch test coverage, so every branch in the program is at least covered by one test case. In further, they even have a stricter metric where they also achieve 100% coverage. SQLite is also extensively fuzzed, also, for example, by Google's OS fuzz project, where they fuzz important open source software. And SQLite also performs many other kinds of testing. I just want to mention one additional example. They do anomaly testing where they ensure that SQLite also performs correctly in the presence of out-of-memory situations, input-output errors, and power failures. And finally, SQLite, and actually also all the other database management systems that we tested, they are mature software, and they are expected to be very reliable. Furthermore, fuzzers are ineffective in finding logic bugs. So fuzzers like EFL that we have already heard today exist that generate random strings. There are also some SQL-specific fuzzers that generate random SQL queries that are then basically fed to the database management system in the hope to trigger a crash. So for example, a segmentation fault triggered by a buffer overflow or a division by zero error. And fuzzers are effective in detecting such crash bugs, but unfortunately, they cannot detect the logic bugs that we want to find. And the final challenge that I want to mention is that knowing the precise result set for a given query is difficult. And as we already heard today in the morning, is that differential testing is often used in such a context to mitigate this. And the idea of differential testing in this domain would be that we have a query generator that generates a query that is then fed to multiple database management systems, for example, here SQLite, Postgres, and MySQL, each of which returns a result set. We could then compare the result set if there is any mismatch between these sets, and if there is, we have found a bug in the database, in one of the database management systems. Now, one main assumption or limitation of differential testing is that it only applies when systems implement the same language. What we found is that the common SQL core that is supported by the various database management systems is very small, so differential testing doesn't really apply to this domain. And this was actually also found before. So the most successful differential testing approach proposed by Microsoft Research, namely Rex, it was very effective and found many bugs, but also the author here stated that one main limitation was the small common SQL core. I also want to mention one other approach. So Kallek and others, they had the idea to use a solver to generate queries, generate data, and also provide a test oracle. In their work, they could reproduce already reported bugs, also find some injected bugs, and potentially one new bug. But here we believe that one main limitation of this approach is that it does not scale well in terms of performance. So in summary, the problem of automatically testing database management systems has not really well been addressed. And this is where our work comes in. So we propose pivoted query synthesis, which is a general approach. It's an automatic testing approach that can be used to effectively test database management systems, and indeed we have found over 100 bugs in widely used database management systems. The core idea of our approach is that we construct an automatic testing approach and also a test oracle considering only a single row in the database. And we refer to this single row as the pivot row. The intuition here is that testing whether the database management system works correctly on the pivot row is simpler both conceptually and implementation-wise, because basically we only need to evaluate the condition on the single given row. We also expect that it has the same effectiveness as checking for all rows, because basically we can iteratively perform this process, selecting all rows in the database as a pivot row, and then check whether the pivot row is fetched. And as I will show you shortly, it also allows us to construct a precise oracle for the pivot row. So let's continue with the approach. The first step in our approach is actually not very specific to pivoted query synthesis itself. So in the first step, we randomly generate a database. And the notion here is that we want to explore all possible database states. So even though our approach would also work for a single given database, here we increase our chances of finding bugs. From this database, we then select a pivot row, So let's here assume that we select this cat plants pivot row. Then we generate a query for the pivot row for which we know that it fetches the pivot row. I will explain shortly how this actually works. And finally, we verify that the pivot row is contained. So we feed this query to the database management system. The database management system returns a result set. And we know that in the result set, this pivot row is contained, potentially also some other rows of the database. So here, if the pivot row is contained, the database management system works as expected. If, however, like here, the pivot row is not contained, but another record is fetched, then we have likely found a bug in the database management system. And we refer to this containment check here as the containment oracle, which is Pivotal Query Synthesis's main oracle. From there, we can actually continue with either one of the steps. So we can either continue by generating a new query for the pivot row. We can also select a new pivot row or randomly generate a new database. Now, the key question is, how do we actually generate this query now for which we are sure that it fetches the pivot row? The insight here is that we only need to generate an expression that yields true for the given pivot row, so that we can insert it into where clauses or, for example, join clauses. And the way we do this is the following. First, we randomly generate an expression. Then we evaluate the expression on the pivot row. We modify the expression to yield true. And finally, we can use it in the where clause. So as I said, in the first step, we randomly generate the expression based on the grammar of the supported SQL dialect and also based on the database schema, which we require to know which columns are, for example, contained in each table. Basically, we construct here this random expression as a tree, as an abstract syntax tree, and let's just assume that we randomly generated this expression here, where animal is cat, and the description corresponds to this regular expression here. Then we evaluate the tree based on the pivot row, and for this to work, we have evaluated a routine in each of these operators that evaluates its children, basically, and computes a result. So for each constant node, the constant node directly returns the assigned literal. So here the cat node returns a cat. Importantly, for column references return the value from the pivot row. So here animal returns cat because this is the value here for the pivot row. Compound nodes compute their results based on their children. So here this comparison yields true because cat is equals to true. And finally, the whole expression evaluates to true, which is why we can directly use it here in the where clause, and we know that the pivot row will be fetched. What should we do when the expression does not evaluate to true? For example, if we evaluate the expression here that animal should be equals to dog. In this case, we have a fix-up logic. Basically, when the result returns evaluates to true, like in the initial example, then we can directly use the random expression. If it evaluates to false, we append this SQL not operator. And since SQL is a free-valued logic, we also need to handle the case where the true value evaluates to null, which is when we use the isNull operator that evaluates to true if the value evaluates to null. So for the example of animal is equals to dog, we would go into this false branch, append the not operator, and then we can again use the expression in the where clause, and we know that the pivot row is fetched. So that's in principle the approach, and let me show now how effective this approach is. So basically, we tested pivotal query synthesis on three database management systems to demonstrate that the approach is general and works well on mature software. So actually, the evaluation that I'm going to present is a previous snapshot. In the meanwhile, we have tested the approach on one new database, and we also found bugs in additional bugs in these three database management systems. So all three database management systems are highly popular. If we look, for example, at the Stack Developer Survey, then we can see that all three database management systems rank among the most popular three. They are also significantly large. So the smallest one, which is SQLite, still has about 300,000 lines of code. And they have been developed and maintained for a long time. So the youngest one is SQLite, which is still 20 years old.
The SQLite code, did you say that almost all of it is test code? Is that included in the test code? Or?
This is a separate repository as far as I'm aware. So this only covers really the SQLite code itself, not the tests.
And then you said the SQLite test is 200 times more than that?
According to the web page, yes. And here is the overview of all the bugs that we found. So in total, we found 99 real bugs. And as real bugs, we consider those bugs that have been addressed either by code fixes or documentation fixes, or which have been verified by the developers. For SQLite, we found the most bugs. And one significant reason for this is that we focused our testing efforts on this database management system because all the SQLite developers, they typically responded very quickly to our bug reports and fixed them typically within a couple of hours up to one day. For MySQL, all bug reports, all bugs were confirmed very quickly. However, MySQL's trunk is not available, so only the latest release version is available, or the source code is available. And additionally, it has a long release cycle, which somehow slowed down our efforts of testing these database management systems because we found too many duplicate bugs and then had to pause our testing efforts. For Postgres, we found the fewest bugs, and actually not all of them have been fixed yet because not all of them could be easily addressed. Most bugs we found with the containment oracle, which is the primary oracle of pivotal query synthesis. And I want to show you one example for each database management system. So here's one bug again for SQLite. You can see here that we create a table. We then create the index. So Shan already mentioned what the index is. It's basically an auxiliary data structure that should never affect the query's result, but only speed up the queries. We then insert two values, namely uppercase and a lowercase a. And when we then select when we then want to fetch all records from this table, SQLite unexpectedly only fetches a single row. And it failed basically to fetch this lowercase a because it mistakenly used this index here, which should only be used in a situation where the casing is actually not relevant, as here specified by this call it no case postfix operator. So again, this was a serious bug which had existed in SQLite for a couple of years, and which was then quickly fixed. So here we have a bug for Postgres, which is actually the only bug that we found with the containment oracle in Postgres. You can see here that we create two tables, and the second table here inherits from the first table. Postgres is the only database management system that we tested that also supports table inheritance. We then insert a value into T0, namely 00. And afterwards, we insert a value 01 into T1. And here, due to the inheritance relationship, the value of the row is also inserted into T0. When we then fetch all distinct rows, basically by using this group by clause here, Postgres unexpectedly only fetches a single row and basically fails to fetch this 01. And the reason for this is that in the implementation of this group by clause, developers forget to consider inheritance relationships. So also this bug was quickly fixed by the Postgres developers. And here is a final example for MySQL. For MySQL here, we create a table T0. We insert a null value. And when we then want to fetch all records where this condition evaluates to true, MySQL returns an empty result set. And this here is unexpected because this MySQL specific equality operator, which should also evaluate to a Boolean value for null values, this should basically evaluate to false because null is not equals to this integer constant. So the negation here should evaluate to true. But here we found the bug that basically for large numbers here, the operator malfunctioned. So also this bug was already fixed by the MySQL developers. Besides the containment oracle, we also found some bugs with an additional oracle to which we referred as the error oracle. I want to demonstrate directly on an example how the error oracle works. Basically, you can see here again a statement sequence for SQLite, where we create a table, insert values, and then update some values. And when we then fetch some records here from this table, SQLite returns an error message, database disk image is malformed, which basically means that the database has been corrupted due to an implementation bug. And in general, this error oracle refers to when we check for unexpected error messages, such as this one here. Also, this bug was quickly fixed by the SQLite developers. In this example here, the insert and update statements corrupted the database. And finally, we also found a lower number of crash bugs, SEC faults, which is expected because database management systems are fast extensively, so we actually didn't expect many bugs to be found through crash bugs. One of the bugs that we reported for MySQL was assigned a CVE. What is interesting is we looked at the number of statements that are required to reproduce a bug. So this here refers to the already reduced bug reports. And here we found that half of the bugs can actually be reproduced with only four SQL statements, so which is most of the time a create table, insert, and then a select statement at least. So it's not necessary to generate large tables in order to find bugs in the systems. I have here one example where even a single statement was sufficient. So you can see here that we have an empty string. We subtract a large number from it, and SQLite had basically a bug where it performed some rounding, which was unexpected. Now, one question is, of course, again, what Ellie also said, are these bugs that we found relevant? And we have here, or I want to bring one example why I believe that they are relevant, namely the SQLite developers. They assigned severity levels to our bug reports, and although they were not very consistent with assigning the severity levels, they assigned critical, severe, and important to a number of our bugs, which shows that that the bugs are somehow important. One question is also always the statement coverage, so how much of the database management systems code we can cover. We found that we can cover around 20 to 50% of all statements. And here, one reason why we don't cover more is because database management systems provide a lot more than pure database management. For example, they provide functionality to for user management, for replication. They provide programming interfaces and additional applications to manage the databases. So here, this low coverage is expected. One question is if the implementation effort is justified. As I've shown you, we need to implement the operators for these EST nodes. And here we had to implement about 4,000 to 6,000 lines of code written in Java per database management system, but this is still significantly smaller than the database management systems themselves. We also have some limitations. The most important one is, first of all, that the approach doesn't work well to test aggregate and window functions, which compute results over multiple records. And finally, we also had some functionality that we couldn't implement that easily. For example, floating point rounding in SQLite worked differently in Java, so we could not fully test floating point numbers, for example. So pivotal query synthesis is an effective approach, but it's actually only one of the approaches we have been working on. So recently, we have also worked on a metamorphic testing approach, where we basically found a way to construct a precise result set, and we also found about 15 bugs with this. And we have also started working on testing aggregate and window functions to also like compensate for the limitation in pivoted query synthesis. And with that, I want to shortly summarize. So I presented you our goal of finding logic bugs in database management systems. I showed you that existing approaches such as differential testing is not really applicable to this domain. So our idea was to consider only a single row in a database, namely the pivot row, to construct an automatic testing approach and the oracle for it. And finally, I've shown you that we were quite successful in finding bugs in important database management systems. So with that, thanks for listening.
Thank you. Any questions?
Thanks for the presentation. Looks like really excellent work. Regarding differential testing, I was wondering whether the differences between these query languages are analogous to one another. Is it the case that one of these databases has just got like its own crazy SQL extensions that is not an analog of in the other DBMSs? Or is it that there are like analogous extensions and could you maybe have like a higher level representation of queries that could be rarefied to each one of those and then you could do differential testing?
So I think that's basically what the REX testing approach by Microsoft did. And I think it works well to up to some degree. So they also mentioned that there are even differences in the handling of null values. So I think it would be possible to some degree model this with a common representation, but maybe not anymore like the extensions that are very specific for a database management system.
Okay, cool. And just a related thing, did you find bugs that did depend on those extensions? By which I mean, like, were you finding bugs that could have been found by different testing, or did you find bugs that actually needed things that you couldn't have used in differential testing?
So it was a mixture of both bugs. So we found also many bugs that were specific to a database management system and its extensions. For example, the bug that I showed for Postgres, table inheritance was only a feature that was supported by that database management system.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, thanks for your talk. one question. In the you said that you create these expressions that yield true and then check that your pivot row is actually contained in the result. Did I understand it correctly? That you don't try expressions that yield false and see that it's correctly not contained?
Oh, that's a good question. So we haven't tried it, but I think it would work to also find additional bugs, namely when the pivot row is actually fetched, although it shouldn't be fetched. Yeah, that's a good answer.
But you haven't tried it yet?
Or? No, not yet.
Okay. I was wondering if there was a reason for this, because it seems very asymmetric to me.
Yes, we will definitely try this still. Thanks.
Okay, any other questions?
To me, it's quite surprising that there are some long-living bugs, some long-living logical bugs in these engines. Have you studied whether there is any correlation between the basically how heavily these features are used in practice versus whether they are just not used by applications? That's why it's not disclosed. And it's been there for a long time.
Oh, that's a good question. So I think that this might be true for some of the bugs that maybe one reason is that they are not heavily used. But I think it's also that databases typically contain many rows and it's quite difficult for developers to decide whether a row is fetched or not fetched. And even if it's still hard to know for the developer whether there is a bug in the how the query is formulated or whether it's a bug for the database management system. And I believe that a number of bugs that we found are also very general, like the initial example that I've presented, which basically consists only of insert statements, updates, analyze, and a select. So for this example, it's not related to some extensions.
So do you see any possibility to be able to kind of explore what is the impact of these bugs in applications in practice? For example, the one you mentioned is quite general, and what impact could it have had on practice, on applications that are or that have been using that version of DBMS?
Right, it would be interesting, for example, this is very much ongoing work, so it would be interesting to, for example, see whether users of the database management systems will, for example, complain on the mailing list that the behavior changed, which would indicate that users are actually affected by the bug. And I think also Ellie and his team recently published a paper on compiler testing and how relevant these bugs are. So I think such a study could also be, for example, performed for database management systems. But I think as a first step, it would be better to find more bugs in the systems. Okay, thanks.
Okay, thanks again.